Do you want to capitalise on the projected growth opportunities in Brisbane? Streamline Property Buyers are your local area experts. With a qualified property investment advisor, licensed builder and rent specialist, making them the most qualified buyer's agents in Brisbane. This team know Brisbane property better than anyone else. Find out more at streamlineproperty.com.au.
Welcome to the Smart Property Investment Show with your host, Phil Tarrant.
G'day everyone, how are you going? Thanks for joining us on the podcast today and coming up into the weekend, which I always do enjoy. And I know a lot of you out there are probably thinking about which properties you're going to be looking at come Saturday. You've probably got your list all set, ready to go. You're going to start burning the shoe leather, get out there and have a look at the markets. It's an interesting time to be in property. It's always an interesting time to be in property, but now in particular, a lot of the information I'm receiving both, you know, through the media, but also stuff coming through my desks from a number of different people, including government, is that things are starting to change a little bit and turn. And there's a lot more positivity, I think, in the market now. We've had the RBA keep rates on hold, lowest interest rates for Australian investors for many, many years, if not ever. You've got the government sort of giving the banks a tap on the shoulder saying perhaps you should make it a little bit easier to secure finance, and some of those restrictions that were being put in place and some of those rules that were put in place in order to shape lending is looking to soften, and you're starting to see that right now. You're looking at clearance rates on auctions. They seem to be going north. There's a lot happening, and it's something that I think I'm pretty familiar with, but I wouldn't say I'm an expert on. So I've brought someone in the studio today to help me navigate some of those big issues about the market, where it's heading and how you can capitalise. Simon Pressley is from Propertyology, head of research. He's a regular guest on the Smart Property Investment Show, and we keep asking him to come back because he appears to know what he's talking about, and you seem to get it right quite often. Simon, how you going, mate? You well?
Yeah, thank you for having us back. I must admit I enjoyed the trip back to from Brisbane to Sydney to participate in these.
What are people saying out there at the market right now? I'll sort of give a bit of a preamble of this market that we're in right now. And I think there's more positive than negative signs, even though there is this big looming recession word that people are banding around. But how are you seeing it? What are people saying on the street?
I think both those things are relevant. There is, you know, since the federal election, a number of positive things, and probably for the first time in 5 years, that there's been some macro level positive decisions for the property market, and there's been a number of them, so that's good for sentiment and buyer confidence, and that was the intention of those changes anyway. But similarly, there is some concern about economic conditions and that sort of stuff. I'm not concerned about it. The economic conditions is largely a byproduct of 5 years of whacking the property sector.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the economic conditions that are now starting to surface with some data that the economists don't like, that didn't happen overnight, and it won't go away overnight. But the fact that some good decisions have been made, I think everyone should be confident that the economic conditions will improve. You know, the fundamentals of the Australian economy are solid.
Pretty strong. And, you know, for every action has an equal and opposite reaction, right? Yeah. So this environment that we're in right now is a product of, to your point, 5 years of just sometimes whacking, sometimes nudging, sometimes pushing the property market. And we've gone through these, you know, regulatory changes around the appetite for banks to lend into property investors that changed the market, slowed down the market. And I think rightfully, did it go too far? Potentially. But this is the market we're in right now. So has it bottomed? And we're talking about the market, and we all know the market means there's markets everywhere. But in general, would you say the only way is up for property in Australia?
In general, I would.
Okay,
yeah. In general. Absolutely. You know, no matter where you live in Australia, no matter where you're contemplating buying property, I think the front windscreen is, you know, the nicest picture that this country's seen for several years.
Okay. That's really interesting. And today, while I've got you in the studio, there's a couple of things I want to try and cover. One is a little bit of analysis about the market, where it's going and how you can capitalise on it. But really, I want to talk about the top five opportunities to look for moving forward, and then also the top five things you should really be concerned about. So that'll give us a little bit of a structure to our conversation, and we'll get to those two things towards the back end of the podcast. But if you're going to articulate this market right now and opportunities for investors, and I know you take a very data-led, analytical, strategic approach to property investing. Nothing that you do is sentiment-driven. I know that for a fact. And I know I've pushed you over the years many, many times to give me some more meat. And I know you hold your cards pretty close to your chest, and I get why you do that, right? I get why you do that. But what are you seeing right now that gives you a positive outlook in property markets? And there's markets within markets within markets. And where would you say those key places are for you?
Great question. I think what we talk about, the the word fundamentals a lot, and we should always talk about that, because when there's a change in sentiment, positively or negatively, it's a bit of a sugar fix or a sour fix.
Yeah.
And, you know, in the case of the two recent RBA rate cuts, it's a sugar fix. And it does what it's supposed to do. It gets us feeling more confident. If we're not conscious of that, we lose sight of the fundamentals and we start to think because of a set of data that's really over a short period of time is a sign of what we should be doing. So always bring investment decisions back to fundamentals. So I think from a capital city perspective, in no particular order here, Brisbane, Adelaide and Perth have the best medium-term outlook. But I'll say what I've been saying for several years about those locations. What is still a very important missing ingredient, and that's private sector job creation. So what I mean by strong fundamentals in those three cities, housing supply, which at one point was oversupplied, is now back to an equilibrium stage and starting to see a little bit of pressure there from a supply point of view. But and they've never had any issues with housing affordability, which is a key ingredient. Growth cycles, we've spoken a lot about in past podcasts. Neither of those cities have seen a growth cycle since pre-GFC days. So they're really strong fundamentals. But the thing that always drives demand the most is economic conditions. Mm. So now when that happens in those three cities, that's when there's the potential for some significant growth. But we're still looking for things to see that happen. Canberra and Hobart have those ingredients now and have had them for some time. So housing supply is still tight. Housing's affordable, probably a bit expensive in Canberra, but Hobart is still relatively affordable. Their economies are strong and the job creation is there. And we believe, you know, we can't see anything why that would change for the measurable future. But we also know that those two cities are in the middle of their growth cycle. And who knows, time will tell, but they might be, you know, close to the end. That leaves Darwin, which is a basket case. Nothing more to say about it, which is sad for Darwin because it's always has a lot of potential. Sydney and Melbourne has had a strong economy since about 2013 and is as strong now as what it's ever been. So that's a plus. Housing oversupply, which is what caused the downturn in Sydney and Melbourne, is still there. And as we saw a few years ago in Brisbane, it will wash out of the system, but it's still going to take a couple of years before that does. The growth cycle is only a couple of years away, so that's an important fundamental for investors.
For Sydney and Melbourne.
To be conscious of. It finished only a couple of years ago. So we'd be completely rewriting real estate history if we expected another one would occur, you know, next year, the year after that. We'd be completely rewriting it. And growth cycles don't occur based on a calendar. They start when economic conditions significantly improve. I don't think that Sydney and Melbourne's economy could get much stronger, to tell you the truth. If anything, I see a reduction over time in infrastructure investment based on state government budgets. And
they've been spending pretty big here and also in Melbourne. Right?
They have, and that's what's in the system now, though. But what's on the drawing board that'll be the infrastructure projects of the next few years, I think that pipeline will be smaller than what it's been because the funding's not there.
Yeah. The challenge is that, and for a lot of property investors, if they're not familiar with how economies work, what stimulates growth, what influences governments to make a particular decision, you immerse yourself in this every day and you can talk about length in it. And it's not too hard to learn. I think if you're serious about being a property investor, teach yourself about these things, learn how these things work. But when you look at Australia and you're talking about our economy here, and I'm no economist, right? This is just Phil Tarrant's my view around a barbecue type of thing, right? But I'd like to think I'm reasonably informed about what's going on. Australia's unique place in the world means that we are highly dependent and reliant on economies outside of Australia.
Yeah.
When you look at the situation right now, potential or saber rattling, at least trade wars between China and the US, they've got their stuff to work out. And this whole idea of when China sneezes, Australia catches a cold, what's it going to mean for us? You know, growth in China is removing. So these are these big global macro economic factors, which will have an influence here in Australia at some point. Now, people will talk about it ad nauseum, right? And and as an investor, I just go, okay, all right, what does that mean? Like you're talking gobbledygook, right?
Yep.
Like just, you know, only a certain amount of people would actually know to the specificness of what someone is saying, just go, okay, I don't get it, right? So what are the key things you think for property investors to be aware of and be across when you look at how global macro microeconomic factors are going to influence Australia and our decision-making here and what the regulators or prudential regulators might do and or infrastructure investment, all this stuff that simulates and creates those fundamentals. Like, cut the noise out. Can you give us something to really look at so that's going to shape how you're going to invest moving forward?
Yeah, I think it's always possible for some people to be paralysis analysis, and some people, you know, they innately want to do something, but the subconscious, the fear, is always looking for a reason to not do it.
It's easy to find it.
And it's always going to be there.
Pick up the paper today, there'll be a reason to tell you not to invest in any given city at any given time or any given regional location.
Yeah. So the Trump and China thing, if you're looking for that reason, there it is. If you go through life thinking about those what ifs, you'll never do anything. And that's the bigger risk. You know, if you don't do anything in life, well, you pretty much guarantee yourself what the future will look like. I personally don't worry about it. It's been a long time. It's been 30 years since this country's been in recession.
Yeah.
So there is, I guess there is a case study, and we did probably 6 months ago, we wrote a report on this is what happened in the last recession.
Okay.
Jump on the website and have a look.
We'll put a link in the show notes for that. I haven't read it. I'll check that out myself.
And it would surprise, the reason we did the blog was in the lead up to the federal election and thought, geez, if it goes a certain way, this place could be in really big trouble.
I think we dodged a bullet. I don't want to get political. I think we dodged a bullet.
But what each recession's different. The cause of it is different. And the cause of the last recession was a global stock market crash. But what we, you know, and again, the evidence is there. It doesn't mean that every property market in Australia tanked, which is what a lot of people would think. In fact, there's several cities that actually had a property boom. So when there's a, especially when there's a major shock to stock markets, some people, you know, don't have the nerve to ride through that and hope they come out the other side good enough. So they take their money out of that. Where do they put it? Certainly not going to put it, you know, maybe back in the last recession when cash rates were 10% or something, they might have put it in the bank, but a lot actually put it in property. And when cash rates now are about 1%, someone took a whole heap of money out of the stock market, where do you reckon they're going to put it? That's where that term safe as houses comes from. So recessions don't be fooled into thinking a recession means a downturn in property prices. The technical definition of a recession is two consecutive quarters where the GDP, which is the national turnover, if you like, is negative. Six months.
Yeah.
All right.
And that could be 0.01%. It just means it's not growing.
Yeah. So it's a scary word, recession, because for most people, they've never lived through it before, or they were never old enough to really care about it. Certainly not a great thing, but it doesn't mean end of the world. What is more recent is the GFC. It was 11 years ago, right? Yeah. And that was described as the biggest global downturn the world has ever seen. Here we are.
Still marching forward. When we come back, we're going to get into the meat of the podcast, top five opportunities to look out for and the top to be cautious of. Back in a moment.
Worried about making the wrong choice with your next investment? You're not alone. If you truly want to become the master of your own lifestyle design through real estate, then you need to speak with Dashdot Buyers Agents, who'll help you acquire cash flow positive properties in high growth areas with value add potential, so you can create more freedom in your life. Visit dashdot.com.au/SPI.
Welcome back, everyone. Here's Simon Pressley, Head of Research, Propertyology, having a good chat. We just went through this whole concept of recession, and is it looming over the horizon? I don't think we've solved it. You reckon no? I'm going to hold your cap, no recession?
I wouldn't rule out a possibility by Christmas.
Okay.
But unlikely.
Okay.
If there was, would I be worried about my property portfolio? Would I be not investing next year? Absolutely no way.
Okay. All right. So let's go with the positives then. Top five opportunities to look out for over this sort of coming 6 to 12 months. Simon, I'm going to let you lead this because this is what you do. So give us a meet. And I'll tell you, on smartpropertyinvestment.com.au, we love lists, right? So this
lists.
It's great for us to write a lot of content around this. So this is going to be a good list story. Where do we start?
Well, top five, I guess these are more dot points than locations, but I'm happy to share some details.
No,
I
want the dot points rather than location. We'll get to locations towards a little bit later.
So five key reasons why I think great opportunities. And easily the number one is the lowest interest rates than any living Australian's lifetime is accessible to us all right now. And there's plenty of people that are saying that they might go again. All right. When we buy property, the not so sexy bit is we buy the debt first.
Yeah.
And if we can't buy the debt, we can't buy the asset. Yeah. So think of it that way. It's the cheapest time that you will have ever had in your life to do something proactive for your future.
But it's hard to get the money, though. Well, it's getting easier, to my opening remarks.
You can't control credit policy,
yeah.
But provided you satisfy, you know, the application conditions, if you can afford to invest now, it's the cheapest time you will ever have to make a proactive decision for your future. When you get age 60 or whatever time it is you want to be financially independent, you'll be thankful that in 2019, 2020, you did something proactive.
So make hay while the sun
absolutely
is what we're talking
have
about.
Have you ever seen interest rates anywhere near as low as this?
No, none of us have. And I know in hindsight, I'm going to be sitting there in you know, 5 years' time or 10 years' time going, you were really busy back then, Phil. You really should have dedicated more time then for getting some more assets at that point in time. Like, you know, I've got a complicated structure. You know, it's not easy for me to get a mortgage. I'm a good customer, but it's not easy for me to get a mortgage because
I've
got to jump through a lot of hoops, the amount of documentation. But I agree with you. Make hay while the sun's shining. Okay, next opportunity, Simon.
Next one is related to the first one. High yields. They're not any higher now than what they've really ever been, but Australia has always been littered with locations with a 5%, 5.5% rental yield. We're not talking like really tiny towns and that's why it's only a 5% yield. Mm. We're talking about locations of substance, locations with diverse economies. In a lot of locations, those economies have a really strong, exciting outlook. So 5% yield, and if you've got an investment property with a mortgage of, say, 4%, even if, you know, for those investors who are getting into the market by tapping into equity to raise their deposit, so they're essentially 100% geared, plenty of investors do that, that only leaves a couple of thousand dollars of your own money that you need to tip in to cover things like council rates and property management fees and that sort of stuff. So it's directly related to the interest rate component. Your profit and loss is dictated, the two main things is your rental income, which is the yield, and the biggest expense will be your debt.
And this goes, I'm going through the process right now of checking in on some of my interest rates. I'm still playing overs for a lot of stuff. And again, it comes back to, I know if I spent some time on it, I could probably save $20,000, $30,000 a year in debt costs on my portfolio just with doing some paperwork.
Yeah.
You'd think I'd get around to it, wouldn't you? But it's true. Maximize your earnings, minimize your expense. It's 101 stuff, right? And I agree with you. It's good time. And you'll see this dynamic moving forward in terms of rising rents.
Actually, just on that, before we move off that, it is important that you review your existing loans. Real story, only 2 weeks ago, my wife handed me a letter, computer-generated thing from one of the banks for one of our investment properties, and usually you don't even look at it. I'm glad I looked at it. So it was the five-year anniversary of, I couldn't tell you which property, but it was a five-year anniversary from when I took it out. And the computer had spat out the letter saying, do nothing and we'll automatically roll it over. You read the fine print and it says standard variable rate. And I'm like, no one pays standard variable rate. You know, what is that? 6.25%. So it's worth taking that.
Were they going to move you to P&I, or was it already P&I or interest only? Were they going to give you another interest only term? Don't know. It's another dynamic.
I can't recall. But you ignore the letter and they go in the bin. 6.25% compared to, you know,
you should be getting low fours,
something like that, is a big difference.
that's called being asleep at the wheel, right?
Yeah.
So Simon said, open your mail. Okay, what's next? Point number three.
Vacancy rates. The capital city vacancy rates that are, you know, published every month or whatever they are, they're very misleading. Mm. You know, a vacancy rate of Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane or whatever, it doesn't mean the whole city's
everywhere
like that. When you get outside the capital city, is those vacancy rates, because the population isn't 5 million or something like that, the number can be more realistic. Large parts of non-capital city Australia have vacancy rates somewhere between 2% and, believe it or not, 0.5%.
Okay.
That's low. And most of them are trending lower. So whilst our biggest cities have been smashed with all-time record supply over the last couple of years, large parts of regional Australia have not had that.
I was timing how long it would take for you to bring up regional locations in Australia, and I want to park that for a moment,
okay,
because I like the point. I think it's important you look at the complexity of a good investment and expanding your mindset out to regional properties based on one factor being vacancy rate. So we'll get in some locations later on. Point number four, and you're talking about This is a bracket for opportunities in investing, like price point.
Yeah.
450 grand, you reckon?
450K, so. Which, yes, if you live in, I don't know, Canberra, Sydney, Melbourne, you think, what can you get for that, you know, dog box. But outside of those three real expensive cities, I guess there's a couple of others in there as well. You know, Wollongong's expensive, Newcastle's expensive, but Australia's a big country. Last time we were on here, we were talking about there's, you know, 185 locations all over Australia with a population of 10,000 people or more, and 111 of those have seen their median house price triple in 20 years. Remember that?
Yes.
So lots and lots of opportunities. Most of those 185 locations have a median house price south of 450. I know you want to know where. I'm not going to say where because we're very active at the moment. But we've bought some properties, you know, in the last couple of months that have got a 2 in the front of the purchase price.
Okay. In one of those 100 and whatever,
yep.
185. By the way, he has no numbers in front of him. These are all locked up in Simon's head, these numbers. He knows them inside out. Okay, and that's good. Look, that sort of, for me, by and large, the strategy that I invest in as well, you know, that sort of bracket of properties.
Yeah.
And you think 450, well, you can't buy somewhere in Sydney on that. Well, yeah, only 3.5 million of the 25 million Australians actually live in this part of the world, right? There is other parts of Australia than Sydney and Melbourne and Brisbane, all good places. But expand. So the opportunity is to expand your mindset in terms of investability, investment grade stock and where that is. All right, yep. Point number five, the opportunities for property investors moving forward.
Economic development. So this is the leading indicator, and to Propertyology, it's always the most valuable gold when we're, you know, in terms of information for picking locations. No particular order here, but industries that have a strong outlook, natural resources, education, agriculture, tourism and renewable energy.
So you're talking about regional Australia again?
A lot of those are.
Yeah, because I could just think of
a lot of those.
Just rattle off a number of.
Yeah, although natural resources, I think when some people, especially if you've spent your whole life living in a big city, the mine probably takes you to a little coal mine or something
Port
like
Hedland.
That. Yeah, good example. But step back from that, and sure, there's people working there with an orange fluoro vest on, but where are the decisions made? So Brisbane is a mining town.
Yeah.
Perth is a mining town. Darwin is a mining town. When the resources sector is strong, there'd be more jobs in those capital cities than in the orange vest, because that's where all the accountants and the engineers and the managers and the directors, and that's where they are.
Well, you've got to think about how, and Australia is a good product of this, and also America, if you want to look at stories around it, is that these big cities grew out of minerals.
Yeah.
So it's gold rush. Everyone goes there. Oh, we need to support it. What happens? Ballarat gets born, right? You know, same again happens in the west coast of the USA.
Yeah.
You know, those cities all originated from people chasing their fortunes to try and dig stuff out of the ground. That's why you have railroads, right? You know, so I completely agree with it. And I think a lot of people often forget that, you know, Brizzy, and I walk around Brizzy or Perth, put your head up, look at the top of the buildings and see whose name is on the side of them.
Exactly.
You know, and that will give you an indicator of what mining means in Australia. It's just not only the great work the guys and girls do in fluoro, digging the stuff out of the ground, it's the mechanisms around it, you know, the mechanics of that. And that goes back to sort of bigger macro prudential opportunities for Australia and the economy. So this whole economic development component in terms of opportunities, you've got to sniff it out and you need to understand it. If you don't understand it, what do you do? Like, I know we try and write about it on smartprintinvestment.com today, but how do you form yourself about these things?
You can write books and books and books about it. It's not a five-minute exercise, but it starts with, I guess, an educated opinion about what are the industries that have the healthiest outlook, as opposed to those that have the least healthy outlook, and then focusing on locations that we give every location an economic profile. All right. So whether it's a regional location or a capital city, what are the main industries that are important to jobs in that particular city? So these are the industries that we've identified there. And then, you know, on a daily basis, we're drilling down, then looking for evidence. And in this case, it's not so much numbers, it's decisions that have been made, whether it's a local, state, federal government, big businesses that are looking to expand or, you know, build something or recruit new people or whatever it is. When you've got an individual town or city that's got lots of those decisions, that gives you enormous confidence that economy is going to improve. It might be a weak economy at the time, but when you get all these exciting decisions when they are actually implemented, that's when you get the job creation.
And that's the art of the investor, is actually work out when things are going to change. You want transitional locations. But, you know, you might be a glass half full, half empty type person. We've been speaking about the opportunity. So I want to get into the things you need to be cautious about, those top five things. We'll do that in a moment when we're back.
If you're a regular listener to the Smart Property Investment Show, then odds are you're already a property fanatic who loves hearing stories on investing from real people, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Be with people just like you and join the group Passionate Property Investors on Facebook now. Become part of a community who know what to do and when to do it. And the time to do it is now. Passionate Property Investors. Tribe, tools, and tips. Find us on Facebook today.
Welcome back, everyone. Here with Simon Pressley, Head of Research, Propertyology. And I want to chat about the things that you should be cautious about moving forward. And you know, cautious doesn't mean put your head in your hands and sob yourself and don't get into property. It means be aware, be informed, and you can see opportunities if you are aware of where these cautious things are. And Simon, the top of your list here, you've got high density newer apartments. Mm. Everyone's talking about these sort of things these days, and mainly around two things. Number one, that they build them and they're not very good and they fall to bits and you can't actually live in it and or rent it.
Yep.
And number two, they're all going to burst into fire because they've got dodgy cladding on it.
Yeah, and that is a real concern. There's enough evidence of that already. Look, in addition to that, and I was just saying before off air, I've spent 3 weeks researching just high-rise apartments and how they've performed over the last 10 years. And what it might look like going forward.
What do you classify as a high-rise apartment? Anything over five stories?
Yeah, probably, I guess so. Five stories is.
But we're talking about big things. You see them in the city. They're huge things, just full of apartments. And then at night time, there's no lights on because no one's in there. tell us about your learnings.
Anything? Firstly, my general advice to people, and then I'll elaborate on why. Now or ever. If you're ever looking to buy a property to live in or to invest, avoid anything that was built from the late 1990s through to including now that is in a high density location. Avoid any building because you can draw a line in the sand, and that's when the regulation changed that allowed, no matter where the location in Australia is, to build buildings with much lower quality control than what we used to have. That's the time frame. Avoid because of that. Why high density? We'll have a report go out next week where every suburb in Australia, we've looked at what the broader city median house price has grown by over the last 10 years, and then we've looked at what's the apartment price grown by in every suburb. I'll give you some examples. Greater Melbourne's grown by 96%, the median house price, over the last 10 years. Locations such as St Kilda, South Yarra, there's lots of them, massive, massive list, but really popular, like inner city, trendy suburbs that people think, oh, it'd be a great place to invest, right? Yeah. Off the top of my head, they've grown by about 20%.
Apartments. So average houses, 90%+.
Not nearly 100, rounded off to 100.
Okay,
right?
And
the medium apartments has grown by 20%.
Within that age bracket, or you're talking about all
that's
apartments?
It's all apartments.
So even like Art Deco stuff is still only growing at that pace. So apartments don't grow as fast as houses.
But, well, they never have grown as fast, but the gap was never like that.
Yeah.
You know, so back in the days when we built the traditional six-pack in the 70s and 80s, in a lot of cases they were really good investments because they weren't mass-produced.
Yeah.
They might have grown by a little bit less than the house next door, but it was probably made up for a bit better yield, so the total return was probably comparable. Mm. Fast forward now, and these things are, you know, massive Lego buildings. There are literally millions of them, and so there is no real point of difference. At the end of the day, a two-bedroom apartment with two bathrooms is the same. And there's, if you're that buyer and you're looking to work out what this thing's really worth before I finalise my offer, you've got hundreds of thousands of comparative, you know, properties to compare it. And this is why there's such a big differential. We're talking, they're real figures. That's the last 10 years. Mm. Gaps as big as 80% over that 10-year period of time. So there'd be someone who bought that, you know, St Kilda apartment or South Yarra apartment 10 years ago and gone, mine hasn't gone backwards in value. You're probably right.
But
what could have it have done, right? Now, that 10-year period has got nothing to do with the structural defects.
Yeah.
That's yet to come.
Mm.
And for everyone in a day, those high-rise buildings in that, you know, 20-odd-year era that I'm referring to, they will always have that stigma. So I believe the differential that I was just talking about there is going to get bigger and bigger, because as the broader Australian public get more educated about what's actually happened, whether it's the defect stuff or whether it's the poor financial performance, less and less people are going to make more informed decisions going, because of when that was built and because of how big that building is, I've got no interest in it. And they should make that decision.
So you're saying that these properties are off forever?
Forever. Absolutely forever.
Are people arguing against you when it comes to this sort of stuff? Like, you know, you must get in some pretty interesting discussions with people saying, well, that don't talk
there'll
down,
be some people
down
who
my
don't
apartments.
Like hearing that, but yeah. You know me as well as anyone, Phil. I call a spade a spade. I don't have a vested interest to say what I say. I make informed statements. Sometimes they're controversial statements, and I've got no doubt that some people will find this a controversial statement. But listen to the logic behind the statement. They've already, over the last 10 years, performed terribly. What happens if, I said round figures, Melbourne grew by, the median house price grew by 100% over the last 10 years. We also know that, not that we can set our clock like this, but when a city has a really good decade, it's usually followed by a mediocre decade, right? So let's imagine that the next 10 years, Melbourne's median house price goes by 50%.
Yeah.
If that differential continues,
it's tiny. You're underwater, really.
You're underwater. And it wouldn't be unreasonable to say that that could happen, because over the last decade, Brisbane's seen about 30% increase in its median house price. Perth has seen about 5%, right? But the decade before that, both those cities did well. So that's the logic based on the historical performance. They have already performed poorly, and that's got nothing to do with all the defect stuff.
And is it going to be like that moving forward, or you think the... Or is it always going to be like that in apartment markets in these big cities?
The high density is why they've performed so poorly.
What do the banks think about this? Because, you know, they must be holding a lot of debt against a lot of these apartments.
Well, their report's probably only 2 weeks old and no one's reported it before. So, but we already know, you know, even before we re-released this data, that banks have sort of clamped down on certain suburbs.
They don't like lending to it because it's oversubscribed. It's too much risk for them to have too much money tied up in a certain type of assets in a particular location. And I get that, right? That's why banks are so prudential in the way that they lend and they ask a lot of questions. So.
Yeah, and that more relates to the off-the-plan purchase today, which I think is a relevant concern. But we're talking about stuff that, you know, was already established, that's already performed poorly.
The argument around this would be just thinking off the cuff, going, we have growing populations in our capital cities and they need to live somewhere. And the way in which people are living, they're a lot more attracted to apartment-based living. Moving forward, you have changing demographics in how families are established, and people now are, you know, might stay single forever or only have one kid. So they want to live in apartments.
Yep.
So someone needs to be building apartments. If we're not building apartments, that means we can't sustain the growth of this great nation. So, but you're saying apartments suck.
I'm saying that regulation changes in the late 90s cause these major structural defects, and I don't think the public realise how common they are.
Yeah.
And if you own one of these buildings and it hasn't had a major structural defect exposed yet, it's probably just a matter of time before it does.
Okay.
It's a bit like buying the fridge with a warranty, and it tends to surface, you know, the day after the warranty expires.
I really, we could do a whole podcast on this, Simon, and I'd be interested to hear what sort of feedback you get on that. And we'll make this report available on smartpropertyinvestment.com.au, so go and check it out, or go and check it out on Propertyology. Yeah, I think I'll be interested to see how this debate develops. I'm not going to take a position on it. You know, I'm just a conduit of information.
I've got no vested interest
here
to say it.
Oh, I know.
My purpose of me saying it is that's not an opinion, just throwing something.
No, it's based
off
on facts. With the facts that you've...
That's based on facts, and we're sharing that information with the public to help them avoid making a decision that I believe they'll be very disappointed about in years to come.
So knowing a little bit about research, did you go into that particular piece of work with the intent to expose that, or you went in with an open mind to just go, hey, look, I really want to find this out because I might find an opportunity in this?
No, we've always... we go back 10 years and maybe not quite that, but 7 or 8 years, we've been sort of saying... Reports are out everywhere. You know, we're concerned about oversupply in certain locations, and then when you strip the supply down to dwelling types in certain locations, it's enormous amounts of apartments. We're concerned that that's a lot more than what demand requires. We've said that for ages. What prompted us to spend 3 weeks? That's an enormous amount of my time, Phil.
You love it,
mate. To look specific at this is the reporting over the last sort of 6 or 12 months about the major defect stuff, and the brain's
just
in process.
It's just going to compound.
Absolutely. The brain was processing that, and I've gone, oh, you know what I'm like? I love data, I love evidence, you know, let's have a look at this. And the longer I looked at it, the more scared I got about it.
You know what? And this really nicely pushes into our next point about what to be cautious of, confirmation bias. So I said, when you went into that piece of work, did you go in there with a bias that you were trying to prove or not prove, right? You went with an open mind. So how do you frame confirmation bias being a caution or a caution that property investors need to think about?
And that's not just I don't put confirmation bias as something to be mindful of just now.
It's always.
At all times. For those who don't know what a confirmation bias is, it's when you've got to make a decision about something and you're going through your information gathering process to make your decision, but the mind is deliberately drawing towards information to support what you really want to do, right? And property investors do this all the time, but they're often not conscious of what they're doing, right? So we all live somewhere, right? So a classic example of confirmation bias is no matter where in the country you live and you're looking to do your research to buy a property, you really want to buy where you live, right? So you're looking for information to say, yeah, this is why I really should buy here. That's a confirmation bias. It's a bit like barracking for your footy team. But you can barrack for your footy team and they can win or lose on the weekend. It doesn't matter, you wake up the next day. But when you buy an investment property, it's an enormous amount of money. You can't take it back to the shop the following day. So always be mindful of your confirmation bias.
It's a really interesting point because I'm doing this right now. So I'm in the process of buying an investment property in Sydney.
Yeah.
And it's a bit of an emotional purchase, but I've proven to myself why it makes sense as an investment. Yeah, you know, like, so I've gone... I know it's going to be a good asset over time, but there is some things where I was going, oh, my money's probably better spent elsewhere, but I'm going, no, I'm going to buy it because of all these great reasons that I've discovered.
So you've recognised your confirmation bias and you've rationalised that there's probably better use of your money, but you're content with that.
I'm okay with that. And I think, look, I can hold the property. It's not a problem, right? So, and over time, it'll be a great asset, but right this second, I could probably buy somewhere else, right? Yeah. In Brizzy or Adelaide or whatever, but you know what? It just is.
Yeah, if you don't listen to your confirmation bias, you risk being really frustrated for years to come.
Yeah.
I did this myself in, would have been about 2008-09, my home city's Brisbane. You know, knew a lot less then than what I know now and bought a property doing my research, but, you know, not conscious back then, but it was a confirmation bias that really determined why buy in Brisbane. And I still own that property.
Yeah.
But, you know, hardly a week goes by that I don't go, God, I could have put that money in a lot other places, and that's what your confirmation bias does to you.
It is, and it sort of extends also to the next point about putting all your eggs in one basket. And I had a discussion this week with a property investor from Perth that flew out here and had a chat. She's a young, hungry investor who started investing at 19. All of her properties are in Perth.
Right.
You know, and we had a really good chat about it, and her LVR's moved to 93%, right, because markets have dropped and she's fully exposed in the Perth market. And I sort of went, I'm not here to give you advice because that's not my job, but a bit of diversification might help. And she went, yeah, probably right.
Yeah. You know? We've all heard that, haven't we? Don't have all your eggs in one basket. There wouldn't be anyone alive who hasn't heard that. But yet, again, a lot of property investors, they're not conscious of that when they're making these really important financial decisions. Mm. And there's a couple of ways. The two most common ways is a person who might have a bigger than average budget to invest in a property. So let's say, you know, I could afford $800,000 or I could afford $1 million. Now, for a big expensive city, that's a, you know, middle ring house somewhere for that price. Mm. It's great that you can afford it. Someone else might not, you know, be able to afford that. They've got a smaller budget. But just because you can afford it, I would argue that that's not the most sensible decision that you could make because you've essentially put it all on black.
Mm.
We spoke earlier, you know, all the locations around Australia with really good quality detached houses in locations with strong economies under $450,000. So if you can afford the bigger budget, think about that all the eggs in the one basket are all on black. Listen to that voice and just think about is that good? Or there's the Perth example that you've used where they've, you know, bought multiple more affordable assets, but that's what's called a concentration risk. It's all exposed in the one market. Now, there'll be some times when that one market does really well and there'll be some times when that market, you know, doesn't perform well.
So it's about minimising your exposure for risk, right? And all your eggs in one basket means a whole bunch of things. It could be, you know, concentration bias. You know, all of your assets in one capital city or in one town. It might be they're all the same assets, so they're all apartments. Or it might be you know, not diversifying out and having some commercial, having some resi, maybe investing in the stock market, you know, spreading your risk that way as well. So it means many, many different things.
Yep.
Fourth point for cautions, Simon. What is it, mate?
Engaging a skill versus engaging a title.
I don't even know what that means.
I guess it's, someone goes through a process and recognises that being a DIY, I'm not availing myself of all this expertise out there.
Yeah.
But just because someone's got a title, it doesn't necessarily mean they've got skill, all right? And make sure that you're chasing the right title. In the property investment field, I guess there's all sorts of financial professions that make this up, but going to, and this is not a derogatory comment towards other professions, but the accountant's the wrong person to talk to about an investment property decision. The financial planner is the wrong person to talk to about that. The mortgage broker is the wrong person to talk about that. They've got a role to play in that decision, but the research into which part of Australia and is this the right property, that's not their role. Mm. Doesn't mean they don't have skill, but recognise where does their skill lie. And then even with someone who's got the right title, it's important that the individual satisfies themselves that do they have skill whilst they might have the right profession. Mm. You know, how long have they been doing this? What's their background in that? What's their experience in that?
It's a good point, Simon, and this is one of the reasons why we do this podcast because, I talk about it a lot. Make sure you're surrounding yourself with the right advisors. So just because someone says on their business card they're a buyer's agent doesn't necessarily mean they're a good buyer's agent. So it's a responsibility of the consumer, i.e. the investor, to choose the people who should be part of their team to support them. Now, there's some great accountants in Australia and they do some great work. A lot of them don't really know much about property.
Yeah.
So make sure the accountant you use, he might have accountant on his business card. Does he actually know about property? Has he got any experience around property? Does he invest in property himself? Has he got some scar tissue? Has he made some mistakes? What does his other clients say about him? So I get that now. You know, so chase the skill, not the title. Be careful who you trust. I don't want that to sound bad, but when it comes to your property investment journey, we're fortunate and lucky that there is a lot of very capable people out there. And if you're unsure, you can go and check out PIPA, which is the Property Investment Professionals Australia, and a lot of those people involved with that are very quality operators. Last point, Simon.
Tunnel vision. So it is related a bit to all the eggs in one basket we were talking about earlier. Tunnel vision, often people just get engrossed with the city that they live in.
Mm.
And they start, and my first investment property, this is exactly what I did. But you don't know what you don't know. So, you know, there I was living in the, you know, middle outer ring suburbs of Brisbane, and I'd tossed up, you know, probably 20 or so suburbs, but they're all in Brisbane. They're probably all still north side Brisbane. But not that anything on the south side really has that much more potential. It's still Brisbane. And that's tunnel vision. Again, you just set yourself up for likely frustration for years to come when you learn more down the track, which is what I did, you know, a few years after buying that first investment property. Proud as punch I was, I thought I had Colonel Sanders' Secret Herbs and Spices.
Mm.
And then fast forward a few years and there's all these other locations in Australia, you know, that perform much better than mine. Well, why didn't mine do that? And I'm like, you idiot, you didn't even consider the fundamentals of those locations.
Well, it goes again, you know, that's my view. There's a lot less opportunities in Australia today than what there was 10 years ago to not be informed about how to invest in property.
True. It's everywhere, isn't it?
You know what? Like, if you go looking for it and if you want information and advice, you can go and find it. Again, be careful who you listen to.
Yeah.
But it's all free. It's easy. You know, but back in the day, you had to go to property, you know, expos to learn about stuff and hear from people. Now you just flick a podcast button on your iPhone and you get to listen to blokes like you, you know? You can't blame anyone anymore for making bad investment decisions.
And none of us have got
yourself.
A crystal ball, have we? No one's got a crystal ball. But, you know, there are some good basic things that we can all follow in terms of decision making and the resources that we use.
All right, let's wind this out. Give us something. Give us something meaty. If people are going, okay, I like all this, Phil. I got my top five opportunities, top five things to be cautious about. What do I do with it?
Yeah.
What do you do?
So I'm not anti capital city. I think some people think I am because for a few years I've been constantly talking about regional locations. Hobart's a capital city.
Yeah.
I think we got that one. I'm objective about all locations. So there will come a time when we feel there'll be certain capital cities that represent the best potential in Australia. Right here and right now, for the foreseeable future, it's still not capital cities, folks. Learn more about non-capital city markets. Focus the most on the job creation stuff. There's a lot more to that than just looking at a city's unemployment rate. The Hobart example, when we started buying there in 2014, the unemployment rate in Hobart was 2% above the national average. So that's not really a useful bit of information. But why do we invest there then, even though the unemployment rate was high? Because we had at our disposal a lot of, we were aware of a lot of decisions that were going to create lots of jobs in that location. And we backed that information and invested on that information.
So what we're talking about is confirmation bias. So I think you gave away some of your secret Colonel Sanders herbs and spices of saying there's 187 locations in Australia with more than 10,000 people. That's where you should be focusing your attention, with diverse economies.
Exactly.
So government, hospitals, schools, tourism, viticulture, agriculture.
There's no magic figure in terms of a population size. Population size doesn't mitigate risk or make it better or worse. The things that mitigate risk and make it better or worse, is, you know, starts with, you said it earlier, Phil, is the economy diverse? Right? If it's not, then that's high risk. But there's risk in everything. Our two biggest cities, round figures, have lost sort of 15 to 20% over the last 2 years. So there's risk in everything. And they are diverse economies, aren't they?
Yeah, definitely are. Thanks for coming down to see us, mate. You know, I always got to work out my geography, Brizzy. So, thanks for coming down to see us. So what's on for the weekend, mate? Did you do anything properly on the weekend, or, you know, the bookend my initial remarks? Are you so obsessed by it? Are you up every Saturday morning running around looking at places, or you got...
No, so as passionate as I am about property, there's actually one thing in life I'm more passionate about, if you can believe that, and that's the mighty Brisbane Lions. So this weekend, I'll answer your question. It's the first time in 10 years that my beloved Brisbane Lions are participating in finals, and I reckon there is just as good a chance as anyone as winning the flag. So I'll be there live with my family and yelling loud.
So you're going to the game?
Proud, absolutely.
So it's up in, the game is in Brizzy?
Yeah, we're first final to sell out.
Okay.
That's how excited the Brisbane
Well, I don't
Brisbane
think you've
City
sold out anything in Brisbane, particularly like your housing market. But
that's a whack, but it's a fair whack. We deserve that.
I don't follow AFL. It's pretty close now, isn't it? Like, when's the grand final? A couple of weekends.
Last night was the first final of the series.
Okay.
So, yeah, we've got...
Who are you playing?
We are playing Richmond.
Okay.
In premiers from 2 years ago. This time 2 years ago, Brisbane were wooden spooners.
Mm.
And we finished this year equal top of the ladder. So
what happened?
Excited.
Like, you know, this is a good question. It's like property as well, right? What happened for that thing to change?
Oh, we're talking about decision making.
Yeah.
Well, you know, my footy club had made lots of poor decisions. Okay. The wrong people in important places. And sometimes the pain's not enough, to realise I've actually got to undo some of those decisions. So, yeah, over a period of time, they put some really good people in good spots. They've got a fantastic culture. They love doing what they do, and they just get out there each day and show their skill, and they're winning heaps of games of footy.
There you go. Mate, it's the best property investors do the same. But thanks for coming in, mate. Really do appreciate it. Remember to check out smartpropertyinvestment.com.au. And please, before I get on to some of the other stuff, those reviews coming through iTunes and all the other places that you listen to this podcast, thanks so much for sending them over. We get a real kick out of them. So please keep them coming. And we like those 5-star ones in particular. If you're not connected in with us on social media, Smart Property HQ, go and check us out. Send us a direct message. We'll get back to you. If you want to come to the show, we can arrange that as well. You can also contact the team editor at smartpropertyinvestment.com.au. We'll be back again next time. See you then. Bye-bye.
The information featured in this podcast is general in nature and does not take into consideration your financial situation or individual needs and should not be relied upon. Before making any investment, insurance, tax, property or financial planning decision, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you. Guests appearing on this podcast may have a commercial relationship with the companies mentioned.
We get it. You're here listening to the Smart Property Investment Show and you're being interrupted by this ad. We value your ears just as much as your eyeballs, so we'll be quick. Join passionate property investors on Facebook today and we'll fill your Facebook feed with useful tips and tools, plus free education from industry experts and a tribe of people who get it. Passionate property investors. Find us on Facebook now.